I'm a friend of Willie's.
What you doing? Drumming up trade for Alvin now?
Yeah, I guess that's what the ice cream cones are for.
Working with an incomplete script forced Redford and Pollack to improvise several scenes.
We got to this big fight scene. There was a missing link. This is where I remember it anyway. There was a missing link in getting into the fight scene. And so we got out there and there was night shooting. There was about 150 crew members out there. And they're all waiting because they want to know what's going to go on. You know, they want to get their assignments and what to do. So they all started crowding in and we're out there with Natalie and myself and Sydney. He says, everybody get back, will you please, give us a break. Can we just have a little time here to work this out? So he backed everybody off out of earshot. And he says, you got any ideas here? What are you going to do?
Making things up as they went established a precedent for Redford and Pollack, a precedent that would set the pattern for every one of their films.
Anxious to get back to it now, too, aren't you?
Yes, I am. I'm anxious to get back, and I'm going. And I meant every word I said about you.
Lying under false...
Yes!
Tricking you.
Yes!
Liar.
Yes! Yes!
Liar.
And coming up, the romantic leading man talks about his leading ladies. Never-before-seen footage from The Way We Were. Plus Robert Redford's funniest outtakes.
Well, he's a very funny guy. I mean, Redford is funny.
A good love story can create a screen legend. And with films like The Way We Were and Out of Africa, Robert Redford and Sidney Pollack have done their best to uphold the romantic tradition. In 1969, Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid was released, quickly becoming one of America's all-time favorite films. Redford co-starred with Paul Newman and Catherine Ross. A succession of hit films made Redford a genuine star, but he wasn't yet considered a romantic leading man.
He'd made Butch Cassidy, and, he was a hot new guy.
What are you doing? Stealing your woman?
Take her.
Well, you're a romantic bastard, I'll give you that.
But in a way, you're not really a leading man until you do a big, successful love story.
I wasn't focused on it. It didn't appeal to me that much at the time.
I wanted it to be a real contest between these two characters, and I knew that I couldn't make the picture work as a real love story with somebody less than Bob.
And Sidney pressed and pressed and pressed.
They kept after him and kept after him and kept after him.
If I push too hard, it's because I want things to be better. I want us to be better. I want you to be better. Sure, I make waves. I mean, you have to, and I'll keep making them until you're every wonderful thing you should be and will be. You'll never find anyone as good for you as I am, to believe in you as much as I do or love you as much.
I know that.
Well, then why?
Do you think if I come back, it's going to be okay by magic? What's going to be changed? What's going to be different? We'll both be wrong. We'll both lose.
Couldn't we both win?
I told him what some of the concerns I had were, and he said they were his concerns, too, and that we would work together on the character to build an underside to him that didn't appear to exist.
Are you still a nice Gentile boy?
I never was. I only looked at you.
That's not true.
I loved Barbara Streisand. She was a pleasure to work with. I really enjoyed that.
Your girl is lovely, Hubble. Why don't you bring her for a drink when you come?
I can't.
Made Redford one of the most sought-after actors in Hollywood. Box office success meant power and more control over his career, but what he lost was a certain amount of control of his personal life.
There was something that changed afterwards. I mean, I could tell in my life, my personal life, suddenly had a different tone to it in terms of me vis-a-vis the public.
One of the things that he hated about becoming
famous in a way was all anonymity was lost. And so the adventure of being able to go and explore places without attracting attention, that ended. I don't feel too sorry for him about it, but it's something that bothered him.
You know, those folks in Africa, or some damn place, if you try to take a picture of them, they'll kill you. They figure that you're trying to take something away from them, and that you just got so much stuff. And if other people are trying to take it all, they ain't got nothing left for yourself. Well, I don't want to be no story.
The elusive and distant leading man became a trademark of Redford romances. Electric Horseman is the story of a love triangle among Redford, a $10 million racehorse, and Academy Award winner Jane Fonda. Redford plays a cowboy determined to set the horse free, and Fonda is a television reporter even more determined to capture the moment on videotape.
Now, how do you know to find me? There must have been 70, 80 reporters in that hotel room, but you were the one that found me.
Just had a few hunches and got a head start.
Well, you had more than that, Alice. You are good.
I just love her. I mean, that's all there is to it. It's just a wonderful relationship. I like working with her as an actress. So what I think, she gets a lot of points for that one because she committed to a 50-page script.
I don't even think 50 pages of script, maybe 35 or 40 pages. And that was literally done on a day-to-day basis. She used to come up every day and ask me questions about what was going to happen. Am I going to end up with this guy? Am I supposed to be in love with him? Am I not supposed to be in love? We didn't know, in a way, how it was going to go. And so we were kind of doing it really on the fly.
When was the last time you were surprised?
You. You were a surprise.
It's a romantic film. I mean, it's not just exclusive to the romance about a man and a woman. It's about a way of life. It's romantic about a way of living in a particular environment. The closeness that comes, the understanding that comes between a man and a horse, that being his profession.
Redford and Pollack's romance with nature has never been more apparent than in the Oscar-winning Out of Africa. Meryl Streep is a fiercely independent farmer against Redford's free-spirited entrepreneur. And the love story unfolds against the backdrop of untamed wilderness.
I thought there was a great deal of romance connected with the country. You know, if there was a Garden of Eden, that's where it was, I'll tell you. You can imagine that life would begin there when you're there. It's unbelievable. And I don't think it's going to last. That's the terrifying thing.
There's country there you ought to see. It won't last long now.
No. I would be wasting your time.
Why don't you get your things?
If you like me at all, don't ask me to do this.
The heart of the story was about a kind of obsessive love that she had for this elusive man. The bags that Redford brought to the screen, this romantic, elusive, minimalist actor, publicity shy, didn't read about him in columns, didn't see him at parties, didn't see him at premieres. All of that was grist for the mill. It was, to me, perfect for this character that she had to be obsessive about, but who was unpossessable, unholdable, ungrabbable. And so after looking, I just felt that he was the best for her.
Karen, I'm with you because I choose to be with you. I don't want to live someone else's idea of how to live. Don't ask me to do that.
It was a tough film for me as an actor because I'd never played a part that was as purely symbolic as that one. It was a character not tied to any root at all.
I have paid a price for everything I own.
And what is it exactly that's yours?
We're not owners here, Karen. We're just passing through.
Is life really so damn simple for you, Finch Hartman?
Perhaps I ask less of it than you do.